Came to him, tempting him, and saying unto him, Is it lawful for a man to put away his wife? They said in Matthew, he reported, for every cause. In other words, can we just divorce a woman for any reason whatsoever? It's almost 2,000-year prophecy of what's going on in America today. Sadly, it's not just in America. You know, we have this thing about we blame ourselves for everything in the world. Did you realize that there are sinners in other countries around the world? Shock. It's like the trouble is with mankind, all the nations, is there sinners everywhere. I do not know, and God knows every person. Can you imagine? He knows every person's thoughts, their behaviors, their words, sometimes very poor choices of words. He knows all of those things, and He still loves us. We have a tendency to sometimes justify ourselves by looking at and examining what other people do or say as if somehow we're better. Look out. That's what he means when he says, Thou shalt not judge. Don't condemn other people because look in the mirror first. I'm not justifying any sin, by the way. I'm just saying we all need to be realistic and understand every person in here doesn't deserve to be forgiven. Nobody. So we all need to humbly approach the throne of grace and mercy. And we can't, praise God. The Pharisees tried to trap Jesus. He took their little trap and he transformed it into a test of them and also to teach. If Jesus agreed with divorce, he would uphold the Pharisees' teaching. So if he said, yep, you're right. The law says you can get divorced. He would have upheld that. It was a trap. If he was against divorce, some people in the crowd would be upset with him because he's against divorce. He knew as soon as they said, asked the question, he knew that no matter what he said, somebody was going to be mad at him. He knew that already. If Jesus spoke against divorce, King Herod might find out about it. And by the way, he had John the Baptist beheaded for speaking out about his impropriety, didn't he? And Jesus fully realized that if he spoke out against divorce, that he would have the king himself, King Herod, on his track. And so he could be arrested and beheaded by Herod. So the Pharisees wanted Jesus to be dead and gone, and they would have been very happy if Jesus would have spoken out and used Herod as an illustration and then been arrested and sentenced to death. They'd have been very happy about it. And have you ever thought about this? There's something wrong when leaders are glad, not grieved, but glad to put down another sinner. There's something wrong. We need to back up and stop and think a minute. There's something wrong when one leader is glad to point out the sins of the other person instead of saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Everybody. Focus on issues. I'm not just talking about political. I'm just saying this happens all the time. People point out something that's wrong with someone else. Sometimes have to deny yourself what you want to do in order to do what's right for your wife. And the other side of that is the wives need to be faithful to their husbands. My goodness, if we could do that, how many lawyers would be completely out of business? They're going to have to learn how to be blacksmiths or something else. Make an appointment. I'd be glad to go over with you privately. I don't want to talk about anybody. I just want to try to honor the Lord and the Word of God. It says in Romans chapter 7, "Know ye not, brethren, for I speak to them that know the law." Now we're talking about Christians here. "How that the law hath dominion over a man as long as he lives? For the woman which hath a husband is bound by the law to her husband so long as he liveth. But if the husband be dead, she is loose from the law of her husband. So one way you can break a marriage is through death. So then, if while her husband liveth, she be married to another man, she be called an adulteress. But if her husband be dead, she is free from that law, so that she is no longer no adulteress, though she be married to another man. Wherefore, my brethren, ye also are become dead to the law by the body of Christ, that ye should be married to another, even to him who is raised from the dead, that we should bring forth fruit unto God." Did you catch that? It talks about us being married to Jesus Christ. When you receive Jesus Christ as your Savior, you become married. Not like we think in worldly terms, but you're married spiritually. You're bonded by him, to him, and you become the part of the bride of Christ, which is the church, the whole church. You become married. Here's what's really important. That we all realize that every sinner can be forgiven of sin if they'll admit their sin, believe on Christ, repent from their sin, and ask to be forgiven, they can be forgiven. Every single one of us is accountable to God and try to live our life with his help in a way that honors and pleases God. Which means we ought to respect and give value to every person that we meet. Every man or woman, we need to respect them. If a person is married, then we need to honor the relationship that they have with their spouse. We shouldn't be hitting on somebody that's married to somebody else. We need to uphold their marriage and protect them. Stand up for them. If a person is not a believer, and a non-believer chooses to leave you, and you're a believer in Christ, and they refuse to be reconciled with you, and they choose to leave you, the Bible allows, because of the hardness in man's heart, it allows you to let that person go, and the marriage is dissolved, and you're free from that person, a non-believer. So death. A non-believer leaves you and refuses to be reconciled with you, you can let him go. And the third one is, if you have a partner who commits adultery, and you're the victim in a marriage, and your partner has committed adultery and leaves you for another person, you're set free and that marriage is broken. You can let them go.